closet, best acoustics in the house. Sorry about the clothing in the backdrop. I wanted to share some thoughts regarding, you know, Jesus' moment in Nazareth where he is asked to read in the synagogue, and yet there sets off a firestorm that really would ultimately turn family and friends into a kind of a murderous mob. I want to walk through this passage that's found in Luke 4 and explore some takeaways that I think will both inspire and challenge our faith. You know, a few questions need to be addressed. The first one is, why did Jesus seemingly flip a switch from teaching to rebuking, you know, based on this community's seemingly, you know, encouraging comments that followed his reading? The text basically states that they spoke well of him and the gracious words that he spoke. The second question follows, really, it follows the response of the community. What initially set the community off regarding what Jesus spoke? You know, was it solely an inherent disrespect for their familiarity with who he was, that they had seen him through the growing up years? The third question is, why did Jesus choose these two Gentile examples? And do these examples relate to the reading he just spoke of a few moments earlier? So let's get to the backstory of this small town located in the southwest portion of Galilee, just south of the Sea of Galilee. It's a very small community, approximately 400 people. You know, basically those 400 would have been all friends and family of Jesus. This settlement was really developed after the Maccabean revolt in the 2nd century BC. And it was developed in response to negate the Hellenistic or Greek influence on Jewish life. You know, the town was a respite for conservative Jewish thought, as seen by the relocation of one of the 24 orders of priests after the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. You know, they would not have relocated unless that town was conservative. The town also was highly nationalistic, which may explain their response toward Jesus' message. You know, here's a slide showing Nazareth's location. This slide gives perspective as to the hilly terrain, and this image right here was taken south of the town. All right, let's set the scene. We can assume that Jesus had been present in the town for enough time to get the flavor of faith and attitudes, you know, based on his interactions with his people. You know, in Mark 6:5, Mark records Jesus's inability to heal based on a lack of the people's faith. It says here he was only able to heal just a few sick people. You know, within the synagogue, a typical service included readings from the Torah, followed by what's called the Haftarah, or readings from the prophets. The scroll is presented to Jesus where he unrolls it to that week's readings. And let's walk through the text, and then we can see and visit some of the nuances that may have stirred all these passions.
He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked.
All right. Indulge me for a moment where I venture into the poetic and chiastic structure of the text. You know, not just for mere knowledge, but to me, it astonishes me how Jesus communicated. Even at my more mature age, it continues to build my faith that Jesus was an extraordinary rabbi and obviously God in the flesh. You know, first, let's look at the text that brackets the passage that he read out of Isaiah. You'll see repetitions of phrases or words in the section above and below the Isaiah passage that they bracket. So here you see synagogue mentioned, standing and sitting, handing of the scroll to and from, the rolling and unrolling of the scroll. In the inspection of these connected phrases and words, you should notice the inverted parallels that are found in verse 16 through 17 and in verse 20. Here we see Jesus' actions in 1a through d, as you see on the slide, that are mirrored in reverse order in 3d through a. You might say, however, so what? You know, this literary technique is really, it's meant to draw attention to the case passage from Isaiah. That's how they operated. All attention is directed towards these words. Okay, so let's look at the text in Isaiah. You know, the bulk of the text originates from Isaiah 61, really verses 1 and 2. In Isaiah 61, the prophet speaks words regarding the announcement of the year of Jubilee, normally an event that's held every 50th year where debts are forgiven, the releasing of all slaves, and returning property to its original owners. In this context, God's anointed was to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance towards those who had harmed Israel. That would have been the Gentiles. The mourning or sadness that's seen in Isaiah 61 rises out of frustration and humiliation over the failure to rebuild the city and the temple, really to match its former glory, and also the failure to reconcile the economic disparities within the city after Cyrus, the Persian king, had released those in exile to return to Jerusalem. This was after many years after the Babylonian takeover. So why is this context important? Many see that the Jews leaned into this passage to expect restoration at the expense of those who had enslaved and capitalized, you know, on their aggression towards them. You know, if you read further in Isaiah 61, it reveals how God would engage and force the foreigner or Gentile into recompensation, both in labor and in finances for restoring the glory of Jerusalem and God's temple. The heavily conservative and nationalistic Nazareth community, I think, would have aligned with this mode of thinking. So the tenor and the flavor of Isaiah 61 was one of both jubilee and one of vengeance. Yet with his edits, Jesus had changed the direction of Isaiah's words. He eliminated vengeance from his discourse, and he focused on compassion, this justice advocacy, and proclamation, as we'll see really in a few slides. You know, as a side note, it was accepted practice for a rabbi to make minor edits in a passage if the edits came from proximity to the passage that was being read. So the writings of the prophets were fair game for this sort of manipulation. However, the Torah readings had to be read with precise accuracy. They would not allow the type of edits that Jesus had done. So, you know, let's get back to the quoted passage that's in Isaiah. Again, embedded in this passage is a chiasm that speaks towards the main issue the speaker, that being Jesus, wants to really highlight. What is very interesting, also is to see that Jesus' use of these verses almost exactly paralleled the Qumran community's thoughts on what aspects would accompany the Messiah. As we'll later see, Jesus inserted opening the eyes of the blind, a statement that's found in Isaiah 42, into this Isaiah 61 passage. This attribute was also assigned to the coming Messiah by the Qumran community. So I think Jesus was really speaking into this cultural understanding, not the nationalistic narrative possibly held by this highly conservative Nazareth community. Okay, let's first look at the guts of the synagogue reading. In it, you'll see the chiasm that pivots on the motivation of compassion. That would be recovery of sight for the blind. This list, as I mentioned earlier, includes proclamation, justice, and advocacy, and compassion. You know, it's awesome to know that that's what Jesus was all about. In its bare essence, this is the summation of really mission and purpose for Jesus. Luke Johnson, in his work, Sacra Pagina, the Gospel of Luke, mentions the beauty of some of the statements captured in this text. In proclaiming good news to the poor would be identified as not just the economically impoverished, but also the marginalized or the social outcast of the day. You know, in stating today the scripture is being fulfilled in your hearing was probably the greatest drop the mic moment in the history of man, because it definitely shocked that group there. So let's get back to the question of why Jesus' hometown was so quick to shift from speaking highly of him to wanting to take his life. This transition, which started in verse 22, where they stated, "All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips," seemed to be really a non sequitur regarding their later actions. First, let's see what might have bothered them regarding the construction of the passage that was read by Jesus. Afterwards, we'll see whether these renderings of verse 22 may shed new light on kind of why they went rogue from 0 to 100 miles per hour in wanting to take Jesus' life. You know, as we've seen in Isaiah 61, that verse serves as the core of what Jesus has read. However, he removes two verses, one that would have caught the community's attention, the deletion of the day of vengeance. You know, why would he not continue to read verses 7 through 10 also? His omission of those verses, 7 through 10, would have infuriated them. Remember, Nazareth was established to build and to plant at the Gentiles' expense. He also inserts a verse from Isaiah 42, a section of scripture that spoke of Jewish purpose to serve as a light to Gentiles, opening their eyes also. So suddenly, a passage that was to serve in utilizing really the Israelites' former overseers or captors, both was to serve them both in labor and financing, now was crafted into a passage of grace. So that brings us to that interesting verse 22. So let's look at this verse and how it's been translated in the past and now currently. So you can see the Greek doesn't communicate, if you look at the Greek here in the slide, it doesn't communicate a positive response from those listening. The Greek word martyrun really has been seen as neither positive nor negative. Translators can translate this either way based on the context of the passage. And the original, you know, the original Greek sentence doesn't have any for or against in the text. So it's basically a neutral setting. So in this case, it has a sense of they confirmed it. The second part of the verse mentions the word marveled. You know, if you ask 10 people on the street when asked their perspective of how that word marveled is used in conjunction with all spoke well of him, I would guess nearly 10 out of 10 would say that this was a positive response to what they saw in Jesus. Again, the word has a wider meaning, also meaning were astonished or were wondering. These words give a different flavor to their experience with what Jesus had just stated. You know, then finally, gracious words can also be interchanged with words of grace. However, in using words of grace, those words actually identify the words that fit the category of grace, where gracious words can speak to the overall tenor of his speech. Just to emphasize that I'm not pulling out the Greek to fit a particular narrative, I think it's proper to mention that most of the original translations, which include the classic, the early modern, the Aramaic, and all literal translations today, capture some form of neutrality of the verse. It's only within the modern translations that we see this bias towards a positive outcome toward Jesus. This issue shift from admiring townspeople to a murderous mob really has confounded many people. You know, it's best that I read directly from Luke Johnson's commentary. Quote, many readers are puzzled by this apparent shift from verse 22. Where the response of the listeners is not admiring, at least neutral, to verse 28, where wrath spills over into attempted manslaughter. Translations which overweigh that verse 22 with theological nuance make this transition even sharper. So simply put, Johnson recognized that the current translations favor verse 22 as a positive response, where if anything should be received as neutral. Okay, so why all this information? Why is it important? You know, what ultimately will change in my life by seeing this? You know, there really are no practical applications here. You know, ultimately, we're looking to Jesus, you know, to see how the Father responds to different situations. For we know that Jesus exactly mirrors the Father. You know, how many of us had a parent who went very quickly from being neutral to being very angry over seemingly trivial matters? And so, is that Jesus? Or is there rhyme and reason to his actions and the actions of this community? You know, I see the structure of how Jesus molded those passages in Isaiah that were deliberate to frame his mission to reach everyone. So let's look at the two examples of faith now that he chose in his choice of these two Gentiles. And is his only story meant to chastise, you know, the Nazareth community, or is there something about these two stories that relates to what he had just read, possibly?
I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years, and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath, in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cured, only Naaman the Syrian.
So what was Jesus highlighting by mentioning these two stories? Was it merely to emphasize a prophet having, you know, no honor in his hometown? And why this comparison really to Capernaum? You know, despite the ordering events in Luke where Capernaum is not mentioned till after this event, the other three Gospels place Capernaum healings prior to this Nazareth visit. At a minimum, Jesus had performed two miracles, one in Cana, that was the water to wine, and the other in Capernaum, you know, where he healed that official's son over in John 4. So there were reference points, there was data to his healings. You know, prior to this meeting in this Nazareth synagogue, Jesus must have heard these rumblings from his neighbors. But again, you know, why did he choose these two examples? He could have mentioned the faith of those that he had already performed in Cana and Capernaum. The two Gentile stories, I think, were chosen to emphasize the faith of others external, not to those within Israel, but foreigners residing in other countries, the widow from Sidon and the Syrian commander Naaman. And this is nothing new within the commentaries. People recognize this all over. These two individuals had exceptional faith. These two individuals had exceptional faith. Not only did it emphasize their faith, but their examples captured the essence of what he had just read from Isaiah. You know, in the Middle East, there was a worldview that a God's power was limited to the country where the God had prominence. You know, that's why Jonah felt that he could flee from the gaze of his God by leaving Israel. Naaman returned to Damascus with soil from Israel because he reasoned that God would not hear him unless he stood on the soil from God's jurisdiction, which would be Israel. And so this widow from Zarephath had no reason to entertain the idea that Elijah's God from Israel would have any jurisdiction over her God, who was Baal, who had commanded prominence in that territory in which she resided. So both Naaman and this widow showed exceptional faith by their actions. She in giving her last morsels of bread to Elijah, if you know the story, when she knew that was all she and her child had to live on. And Naaman traveling to a vassal country to enlist the help of a prophet to heal him of his leprosy. So the Nazareth community, you know, they wanted proof of concept from Jesus without an investment on their part. I think Jesus really was looking for authentic faith, a faith that engaged both intellectual belief and action. You could see those in those two Gentile moments. Finally, let's examine what was embedded within these two examples of healing that portrayed what Jesus had just read in Isaiah. Remember, the key takeaways from the chiasm were proclamation, justice, advocacy, and compassion. You know, with the widow and with Naaman, all three were present, especially when viewing the widow. Here in this story, we see a member of society who does not have support and also needs advocacy. And obviously Elijah and God respond to her with compassion. You know, the same with Naaman. Proclamation and compassion are evident in his case. However, justice and advocacy are also exhibited when he initially rejects the command to wash in the Jordan, but then his servants intervene on his behalf to reason with him. Proclamation, justice, advocacy, and compassion, they're very simple yet very challenging. So one last really beautiful connection that Jesus makes in connecting these two stories is that in the case of the widow, Elijah is sent out to her, whereas Elisha, Naaman comes to him. We should have a faith community that attracts others, you know, based on our love and reputation for one another. We also should be active in going out to meet others on their turf. You know, where it says in Isaiah, "He has sent me," clearly this is seen in the Elijah widow example. Then later in Elijah, it states to send forth the oppressed in deliverance. You know, you got to think, isn't that what Elisha did with Naaman? He sent this healed man back to his own country. So the final scene of this drama has Jesus led out of town to a cliff to be thrown off. Here, I don't want to comment on this mob mentality. However, a good friend of mine pointed me to research by Rene Girard, a literary expert and anthropologist. He studied community behaviors, and he coined this term called mimetic theory. This theory explains the willingness of a group of people to lynch or gas their fellow humans, or jointly vent their feelings towards a target at a community meeting at the drop of a straw, and well before they understand what's going on. So Girard advanced the understanding of mimetic theory using illustrations throughout history to explain conditions when crowds don't behave well and they succumb to a single cause for all their collective problems. They then select their victims, they transfer their own guilt and anxiety, they take severe action, and they move on with a myth about what happened. You know, if the town folks of Nazareth were offended, they were even more susceptible to this type of groupthink. How did Jesus navigate this moment to be able to walk away unharmed? Marty Solomon, on his Bama podcast, suggested that the group was prompted to refrain once they realized that they were breaking Levitical law and not having at least two conferring witnesses to an offense.
How long have you had these droids?
About 3 or 4 seasons.
They're up for sale if you want them.
Let me see your identification.
You don't need to see his identification.
We don't need to see his identification.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
These aren't the droids we're looking for.
He can go about his business.
You can go about your business.
Move along.
Move along. Move along.
Many of us also envision maybe an Obi-Wan Kenobi mind meld, where he placates the enemy stormtroopers by mere suggestion. Whatever the case, it was not his time to die.